Scholastic Audio presents Spirit Animals, Fall of the Beasts, Book 6, The Wildcat's Claw, by Varian Johnson, read by Nicola Barber. Chapter 1. LENORI. LENORI paced her cramped quarters, which were little more than a small, single holding cell with meagre wood furnishings. She hadn't had contact with Olvan or any other greencloaks since being imprisoned. Most of the others had been captured and returned to Greenhaven Castle, where they would be held for trial. But she and Olvan remained in the Council Citadel. Olvan. He'd been struck by a stone viper's fangs, and most of his body was turned to stone. Thanks to her rainbow ibis, Miriam, LENORI could sense his presence. He was in pain, but alive, though she didn't know for how long. She didn't know how long any of them had. The second devourer war had taken a heavy toll on all the nations, and the worm's destructive reign of terror only amplified people's fears. The Greencloaks had saved the world, but it had come at a great price. Despite their best efforts, many people had suffered. Zarif, under the worm's control, had used his immense powers to ravage the world. But these battles weren't just fought in far-off lands like Stetriol or Arctica. There was bloodshed in every village. Neighbor against neighbor, brother against brother, mother against daughter, father against son. The Greencloaks themselves had inflicted some of the worst damage. Zarif, armed with the worm's parasites, had taken control of most of their order and had then turned them loose to wreak havoc in every corner of every land. There was no village, no militia, and no army that could prevail against a legion of Greencloaks when they partnered with their spirit animals. With their true, uninhibited powers now unleashed, the Greencloaks had shown the world just how powerful they'd become. People were afraid of them. They were angry. They were distrustful. And LENORI couldn't fault any of them for feeling that way. She and Olvan thought that by coming here to meet with the leaders of the nations, they would be able to soothe any doubts and remind the world that the Greencloaks only wanted to preserve peace. They had even brought along the four heroes of Erdas, each from a different nation, but united in their oath to serve and protect all lands. But thanks to traitors within their midst, the Emperor of Zhong had fallen, and the real Greencloaks were left to take the blame. LENORI pressed her ear against the door to make sure that no one was nearby, but heard only a quiet dripping from the citadel's leaking roof. She released Miriam from passive state. The ibis strutted around, proudly displaying her rainbow feathers and shaking her long, thin legs. "No time for showing off, Miriam," LENORI said. "We must find our young friends." She sat down on the stone floor and closed her eyes. She pushed the cold of the room, the fear of her imprisonment, and the worry for her fellow Greencloaks from her mind. Her pulse slowed, and her body relaxed. It was just her, Miriam, and Erdas, united as one. A hazy image floated before her. She concentrated, trying to sharpen its edges, trying to bring it into focus. It was a ship cutting across the ocean. Squeezing her eyes tighter, she saw the four heroes huddled in a small room. No, not four. There were six of them. They had been tested recently. She could see the weariness on their faces. But they exuded a sense of accomplishment. Her mind centered itself on Rollan. Her gaze fell to the thin leather strap around his neck. The heart of the land. He had revealed it. She heard something in the distance. Echoes? Footsteps? Was there danger on the boat? A trap waiting to be sprung? She shook her head. Those sounds weren't coming from the ship. Someone was approaching her room. She blinked, and her mind returned to her cell. She looked at the Ibis sitting calmly beside her. Miriam, back to me. I don't want them to know that you've been loose. The rainbow Ibis disappeared just as the heavy wooden door swung open. Two oath-bound warriors, both dressed in black, entered the room. She recognized the one with the short blonde hair. Sure enough, the woman's brown stone viper flashed into view, curling around her large arm. Brynhild the Merry. She was the one who'd poisoned Olvan. The other warrior was new to LENORI. Like Brynhild, this woman wore a black uniform with brass neck and wrist collars, but the woman also sported shiny, gaudy rings on most of her fingers. Her long brown hair was twisted into an intricate braid that trailed over her shoulder, like an embroidered rope hanging from a curtain. The unknown woman snapped her fingers, and a servant entered the room, carrying a tray full of breads, dates, and cheeses. LENORI willed her stomach to remain silent. It was the first food she'd seen in 2 days. The servant placed the tray before LENORI, then left the room. The woman with the long braid took a step forward. "Don't you want to eat?" LENORI pretended that the food wasn't there. "No, I want to be set free." The braided woman shook her head. "Don't ask for the impossible," she said. "Go on, take a bite, eat it all. Gorge yourself." She grinned. "I promise it isn't laced with stone viper venom." LENORI instead curled her hands into her lap. "What do you want from me?" "We know why your young friends were in a mire," the oath-bound woman said, whipping her braid over her shoulder and behind her back. She began to pace, her boots echoing on the scarred stone bricks. "For such a small amulet, it carries quite a punch. The children were lucky to escape with it." She pulled a red-tinged sword from her side. It sparkled as light hit its blade. "We've heard reports that they're on a ship headed for Yora," she said. "What's there? Another of these so-called gifts?" LENORI stared ahead, saying nothing. The woman knelt so that she and LENORI were face to face. Her hazel eyes were as cold as the floor. Then she placed her sword on the ground, well within Lenori's reach. It was almost as if the woman were daring LENORI to try to grab it. "I understand that you don't want to betray your friends," the woman said, "but they're just children. They shouldn't be fighting these battles. Take pity on them. Spare them any further pain and hardship." "They've saved the world twice," LENORI said. "You should not underestimate them." The woman inspected her own hands, tracing her fingertips across her numerous rings. The ring on her middle finger was adorned with 3 small, cone-shaped spikes. She twisted the ring so the spikes pointed from the inside of her hand. Then, with a wry smile creeping across her face, the woman slapped LENORI. LENORI cried out, more from the shock than the pain. Then the woman struck LENORI again, even harder. Lenori's face burned. The woman's ring had left its mark. "And you should not underestimate me," the woman replied as she twisted her blood-tipped ring back into place. LENORI let her gaze flicker to the sword lying on the floor. She considered lunging for it, but stopped herself. She was sure that was exactly what the woman wanted. LENORI refused to give her the satisfaction. Leaving the sword on the floor, the woman picked up a loaf of bread. She tore off a small piece, then popped it into her mouth. "Delicious." Then she held the bread under Lenori's nose. "I know you want a bite. You must be delirious with hunger." LENORI shook her head. The woman sighed, then ate a larger piece. "Where are they going, LENORI? What are they searching for? Is there another gift out there? Is it just as powerful as the heart of the land?" The woman dropped the remaining bread on the tray, picked up her sword, and returned to her feet. "I promise, if you help me, I will capture them safely and return them unharmed. The woman glanced at Brynhild. You know what happened to Olvan? I would hate for a similar fate to befall those children.
You'll never find them, LENORI said.
For the first time since entering the room, the woman stopped smiling.
Perhaps another 2 days without food will help you change your mind.
She snapped her fingers, and the oath-bound warrior returned. Lenori's insides seized as he picked up the tray. The braided woman held up her hand, signaling the warrior to stop. With her sword, she sliced off a minuscule hunk of cheese, barely enough to fill a thimble.
On second thought, why don't you keep a piece? She said, tossing the food at LENORI.
It bounced off her leg and landed on the floor beside her. Specks of dirt covered the once pristine cheese.
See how kind I am? I could have left you with nothing.
The woman stepped out of the room.
But like that food, my kindness will not last forever. Tell me what I want to know, or prepare yourself for death.
The door slammed shut, leaving LENORI in silence. She picked up the small slice of cheese. Her mouth watered. It smelled even better once in her hands. Then, slowly, she ground the food between her fingers, disintegrating it. Her faith may be tested, but she would not falter. She was a greencloak, committed to the end, no matter what.
Chapter 2. Across the Ocean.
Conor glanced out of the porthole of the sleek clipper as it sliced through choppy seas and strong winds. They had boarded the boat in a small coastal town just north of Concorba. Thanks to a small collection of coins from Worthy and Rollan's skill with negotiations, they had been able to secure a cabin with 4 beds, along with 2 packs of meagre provisions. The room wasn't nearly big enough for all 6 of them to comfortably sleep at one time, but Conor and his friends weren't in the position to be choosy. Stepping closer to the window, Conor squinted at his reflection in the dirty, smudged glass. He reached to his forehead and ran his fingers along his skin, right where the mark of the worm used to be. The black, swirling mark had faded from view, but he could still feel its power, its weight. It was an invisible burden he feared he would carry for the rest of his life.
"See anything of interest?" a voice asked behind him.
Smiling, he turned around. Abeke was always light on her feet, even with Uraza, her leopard, in passive state on her arm. Conor flexed his own forearm, watching his muscles ripple underneath Brigand's mark. He hated leaving the great wolf in passive state for so long, but their current mission required stealth, not strength. Conor looked back out the window and stared into the distance.
It could be a mirage, but I think I see land in the distance.
I just spoke with the captain, she said. We'll reach port soon.
Conor grinned. Yura. Green fields, light blue skies, and a cool breeze on his face.
Do you think I'll be able to see my family? Conor asked.
Although he had seen them recently, he always loved spending time with his parents and brothers. He didn't even mind getting up early in the morning to herd and shear the sheep. Seeing his family helped remind Conor that, as a green cloak, he not only fought to protect Erdas, he also fought to protect those closest to him.
I could show you guys a real Yoren meal, he continued. Shepherd's pie and all.
Abeke frowned, which was more than enough of an answer for him. Rollan had gone to see his mother in Amaya, and as a result, the Oathbound had almost captured them. If it wasn't for Worthy, they probably wouldn't have escaped. Abeke saw something in his face, perhaps worry for his family, because she suddenly smiled and said,
Maybe the bounties put out for us by the Oathbound haven't yet reached all parts of Erdas. If so, and if time allows, I'm sure you'll be able to see your family, and it would be nice to have a normal meal for once.
She turned to their friends, still asleep.
We should wake the others.
You wake up, Rollan, Conor said,
pointing to one of the cots on the other side of the room.
He's always cranky when he doesn't get enough sleep.
Conor went to rouse Worthy and Unka while Abeke crossed their quarters.
Worthy was curled into a fetal position on his bed, his red cloak draped over his body. Conor wasn't sure, but he thought that he might have been purring in his sleep.
"Get up, Worthy," Conor said, giving him a slight nudge.
The red cloak yawned and stretched, his golden eyes blinking behind his white, cat-shaped mask. Worthy tried to stand, but became unbalanced with the shifting of the ship. He slowly sank back to the flat mattress.
"You should have woken me when we reached land."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.